corner of Shrewsbury town centre has seen such great change over such a short period of time as the area between the main shopping streets and the River Severn. It's an area seemingly poised for the biggest changes in its history. But, as we shall see, this is a place where big changes have been happening for the last 150 years. We're going to take a look at how the appearance of the riverside area has altered over time. But to start with, let's define the area that we'll be looking at. We'll be going around the perimeter first, essentially following the line of the town's medieval and later defences. So firstly, down Meadow Place, along Smithfield Road, up Rouse Hill, and then along the back of properties on Pride Hill, Castle Street and Castle Gates, overlooking Raven Meadows before looking at the large space in the middle. Meadow Place is first heard of in 1814, but a lane must have existed much further back in time to service the medieval wall that ran along it. This extended from the castle down to the river, and even before that, a lane probably followed Saxon defences along the same line. At the top of Meadow Place stands the Bingo Hall, originally opened as the Granada Cinema in November 1934. A photographer was fortunately on hand to record the construction of the cinema. This was a site that had been marked by quite rapid change. The cinema replaced these Victorian corner properties. They had been relatively short-lived, as only a few years earlier, these smaller 19th century houses and shops were on the same site. Travelling down the lane, the left-hand side is now mostly a car park for the Beaconsfield Club. But until the early 1980s, there had been a row of 19th century houses, and these were demolished despite the urgings of conservationists that they be retained. On the right-hand side, there are remnants of the medieval wall. This wall was built in the early 13th century, but almost certainly there would have been earlier Saxon defences along this line, which would have protected the only route into town that didn't require an attacking force to cross the river. As we round the corner near the bus station, we can see that another 19th century terrace has survived. But all is not as it seems. The building on the corner, the Beaconsfield Club, looks as old, but is in fact a pastiche of a late Georgian building demolished in the early 1980s. It's seen here prior to demolition. Looking back in the other direction, up the slope of Meadow Place in this rare early 19th century engraving, we can see much that helps us piece together the story of this area. We can see the late Georgian building standing alone. Despite their similarity of appearance, it must have been at least 30 years older than its neighbours on either side. The houses that were to be demolished in the 1980s and those that survive today had not been built at this point. There is a fascinating view of the medieval wall on the left. No other detailed image shows it complete with its wall walk, along which patrols could have been mounted in times of tension. The wall walk was removed in the late 19th century, although parts of the wall itself survive. The section of wall nearest to us went even earlier for the construction of a new street in 1835, that is, Smithfield Road. Incidentally, this new thoroughfare was the first in the centre of the town to be called a road. Since then, only one other, Priory Road, has been added to that list. Shrewsbury has retained its ancient street names to a remarkable degree. The wall continued behind this view all the way to the river, where it turned a sharp corner at Garraweld's Tower to run for a short way along the river frontage to Gilbert's Tower. The stonework in this view across the river, which remains today, is probably part of those medieval defences. Garraweld's Tower itself is intriguing. It was known as Garraweld's Castellum, which seems to indicate something rather more substantial than just an interval tower. Garrowald itself is a Saxon name and suggests that it may well have been the site of a major structure in the Saxon defence line, important also perhaps because it overlooked a fordable and therefore vulnerable section of the river. As can be seen on the Burley map of round about 1575, until the 1640s, the time of the English Civil War, the wall stopped at Gilbert's Tower, about 70 metres southwest of Garrowald's Tower, leaving Raven Meadows exposed to enemy attack. Perhaps the low-lying marshy nature of the site was originally thought sufficient to defence. We can also see how the town wall behind Mardol had largely disappeared by the 16th century. During the Civil War, however, first the Royalist defenders, and then their Roundhead opponents, who had seized Shrewsbury in 1645, extended the line of the walls from Gilbert's Tower all the way to Mardol and the Old Welsh Bridge, thereby protecting Raven Meadows and plugging the gap left by the disappearance of the wall on Mardol. These defences were faced with stone from Shrewardine Castle, which had been demolished by Cromwell's men. They also used the stone to repair Shrewsbury Castle at the same time. We know from documentary evidence that the wall was not completed until 1651, which strongly supports the idea that these were largely Cromwellian defences. The walls can be seen in the distance in this rare 19th century view overlooking Raven Meadows, which shows people walking along the top of them. The wall was repaired, and the footpath was rendered more commodious by the corporation in 1818 to 19. The young Charles Darwin is known to have used this walkway as a shortcut to his home on the Mount from his school in what is now the library. He was once injured when he fell off it. During severe floods in 1831, a bargeman in a fishing coracle is known to have sailed it over the walls for a bet. The ground was deliberately built up in the 1850s for the Smithfield Market, and the wall was seemingly buried rather than destroyed. The top of the wall was briefly exposed when the old Riverside Medical Practice was constructed in the 1980s. It was also visible in the cellars of the now demolished Victoria Hotel nearby. It is very likely that substantial parts of this Civil War wall, or Rouse Hill Wall, as it was commonly known, survive today under Smithfield Road and adjacent land. Smithfield Road served as the main route to the markets on the site, which we shall look at later. By the early 20th century, it was deemed to be too narrow for the traffic it was carrying, not only the market traffic, but much of that using the Welsh Bridge. In 1938 to 39, one stretch of Smithfield Road was widened by extending it on piles over the river. At its northern end stood a toll house for the collecting of market tolls, which was later known as Corporation House and which is now demolished. Nearby was built a mortuary that has seen a number of uses, including one as a boxing club. It is now a riverside restaurant. At the southern end of the road, just before the turning into Rouse Hill, stood the Victoria Hotel, a very popular hostelry with market traders during its 100-year life. The hotel had 5 bedrooms and plenty of stabling for horses. It was demolished in the mid-1960s, not long after the closure of the cattle market, from whose custom it took much of its trade. Another pub linked to the market was the Globe Inn, which became the Smithfield in 1916, and the proud Salopian after 1959 when the market moved. Happily, it still exists today as a popular real ale pub. For the last 170 years, Smithfield Road has acted as both a very busy thoroughfare and also as a physical barrier between the town and the river, in marked contrast to the rest of the river loop, where pleasant, traffic-free walks and adjacent leisure spaces are the norm. We now turn into Rouse Hill, a medieval street which lay partly inside and partly outside the 13th century medieval walls. Indeed, it was probably created at around the same time as the town walls themselves, as a shortcut from the main shopping streets down to Raven Meadows and the river, a role it still performs today. Rouse Hill was a much narrower lane until the 1960s, when there was much demolition to allow for access to new developments on Raven Meadows. The whole of the northern side was removed, including the properties seen here. Like nearby Mardol and Frankwell, Rouse Hill also had a quayside, albeit only a small one. Warehouses such as this one, which survived into the early 20th century, would no doubt have serviced that river trade. They can also be seen on the left in this rare view looking down the slope. The photographer seems to have been attracted to the scene by recording the high flood levels, probably in the 1860s. It also shows the predecessor to the Horseshoe Inn that we shall see elsewhere in this tour. This structure seems to be late 17th century or very early 18th century in date, and was at the entrance to a very poorly recorded little street to its side. Let's take a look at this little street. It was originally called Cross Lane, and as the name suggests, it was the route across Raven Meadows below and behind the houses on Pride Hill. The building of the town wall in the early 13th century had sliced through the strips of land or burgage plots behind those houses. Their owners now had to reach the tail of their plots by going along to Rouse Hill, down to a gate in the town walls, and then walking along Cross Lane. It also provided a convenient route to Raven Meadows as a whole. The vestiges of those burgage plots behind Pride Hill only finally disappeared in the late 20th century, with the appearance of the surface car park in the gap between the two big shopping centres. It took some time for Cross Lane to be built up with houses, but between the time of Speed's map of round about 1610 and Roke's map of 1746, both sides of the lane were built up. The Horseshoe Inn on the corner of Cross Lane and Rouse Hill, which we've just seen, would have been built at that time. Remains of a late 17th century building were found during archaeological investigation in 1997, but images of the lane with standing structures are extremely rare. This is an early 20th century view taken halfway along Cross Lane, by then confusingly also known as Rouse Hill. The cottage on the right is probably very early 18th century in date, but in the distance there is what appears to be an even earlier timber-framed building. The old slaughterhouse buildings on the left were replaced in 1911 by a new abattoir with up-to-date facilities to better serve the Smithfield cattle market. A few years before this photograph was taken, the Shrewsbury Electric Light Works were built in 1893 at the end of Cross Lane, although it was to be some time before most Shrewsbury homes were supplied with electricity. The chimney of it can be seen in the distance behind these participants in this early 20th century carnival procession. Cross Lane survives today along roughly its original line in the form of the street now named Raven Meadows. However, this modern version of Cross Lane is much wider and considerably longer, as it extends through to the bus station and round to Smithfield Road and acts as a service road for the shopping centres and multi-storey car park. In the late 19th and early 20th centuries, Rouse Hill had a very unsavoury reputation as the town's red light district. The scale of prostitution was revealed by the enumerator of the 1861 census, who, unusually for that time, described the trade of the women involved and the premises they operated in rather frank terms as prostitutes and brothels, rather than using the normal euphemisms of milliners, household servants, and lodging houses. The concentration of most of this sex trade in Rouse Hill and the shuts that led off it became particularly marked after many prostitutes were displaced from their former homes on Castle Hill. This had been demolished to allow the construction of the railway station from 1846 to 48. The removal of Sheep's Head Shut at the end of Mardol to widen the entrance to Smithfield Road round about 1850 also contributed to the displacement of what today would be called sex workers to Rouse Hill. The closeness to the market and the ready supply of nearby public houses, such as the notorious Horseshoe Inn, first recorded in 1861 and seen here in its rebuilt form, and further up the street, the Sun Inn, first recorded in 1828, facilitated this business, which seems to have been mostly transacted in properties along the shuts or passageways between Mardole and Rouse Hill, such as Phoenix Place or Mason's Passage. As we exit Cross Lane and go further up the slope of Rouse Hill, we cross the line of the medieval town wall. The wall had long been in disrepair along the back of houses along Mardole. The Burley map sees them barely still extant in 1575, but further destruction of the town walls in the area was to happen surprisingly recently. A small section in Rouse Hill was revealed in the late 1950s, when an archaeological investigation turned up much useful information about the town walls generally. In 1969, a long, tall section was removed during building work at Charles Clark's garage on the corner of Cross Lane, or Raven Meadows as it was now called, and a widened Rouse Hill on roughly the site of the Old Sun Inn. This was close to the former premises of Shuker's, with whom the Charles Clark organisation had merged. Extraordinarily, in 1985, yet more of the town wall, further up the slope to Pride Hill, was removed for the construction of the Pride Hill Shopping Centre. At the top of Rouse Hill, known here as Rouse Hill Bank, we reached the junction with Pride Hill. And here is Lloyd's Bank, which occupied a heavily modified timber building on the corner until its replacement in 1968 by the award-winning concrete structure that's on the site today. The eastern perimeter of our site is defined by the ridge on top of which stands Pride Hill, Castle Street and Castle Gates. This ridge was formed by the River Severn in prehistoric times, when the Severn eroded the higher ground to form it. Later, the river channel retreated to leave low-lying marshy land that was to become the future Raven Meadows. By the Saxon period, a patchwork of field boundaries had appeared linked to urban plots on the ridge above, that is, the houses along Pride Hill, Castle Street and Castle Gates. These streets have long been the primary shopping streets in the town, and so it's no surprise that they were home to some of the wealthiest merchants of medieval Shrewsbury. The survival and restoration of parts of some of these merchants' houses from the 13th to the 15th centuries, whilst very patchy, has been remarkable, and is in marked contrast to the recent destruction of most of the medieval town wall in the area. The town wall itself ran from Mardole and Rouse Hill up to and along the ridgeline to Meadow Place. There would have been a ditch running below and parallel with it that no doubt survives deeply buried under the modern ground level. The first property we see along this ridge is Bennett's Hall, otherwise known as the Old Mint, due to a local tradition that it was used as such during the Civil War. This is the earliest of the surviving stone halls of the town and dates from the 1250s or 60s. It was originally accessed off Rouse Hill Bank, but today can be seen within modern retail premises on Pride Hill, apart from its end gable, which stands alone at the rear. Its restoration in the early 1960s was, despite its shortcomings, a milestone of enlightened conservation in the town. This pre-restoration view along Leopard's Shut, later known as Perslow's Passage, shows a doorway to a first-floor room, which is now exposed within the shop, as is the undercroft, and an extremely fine fireplace, one of the best of its type in the country. Sadly, the tympanum, or decorated head to the doorway, didn't survive the restoration process. It was the earliest secular use of Grinsill stone in the town. Moving northeastwards, we come to the back of 10 to 12 Pride Hill, known officially as Pride Hill Chambers. It started life as a medieval merchant's house of round about 1400 and was probably timber-framed over a stone undercroft. It was built on top of the town wall, which was reduced in height to accommodate it. Like most of the known medieval houses of the 13th and 14th century, the main hall lay in a courtyard off the street. That courtyard survived until 1971. But by then, the upper parts of the hall had been replaced by Georgian houses in the 18th century. These were demolished and the courtyard built over. Speed's map notes the line of the town wall built upon by houses, a process that seems to have begun as early as the 15th century, if not sooner. It can't have been ideal for the defensive qualities of the town wall, especially when doorways or sally ports, like this one in Pridehill Chambers, were then inserted into the wall. No doubt it was easier for the merchant to access his plot of land below the wall this way, rather than having to get to it the long way round via Rouse Hill and Cross Lane. In any case, by the 15th century, the threat of Welsh attacks seems to have diminished, with the notable exception of Glendower's revolt of 1400. By the 1970s, the whole building was in serious disrepair, and as we've seen, the Georgian houses around the courtyard had been removed. Happily, the medieval parts underneath were retained and incorporated into a McDonald's restaurant. And until recently, generations of Salopians were able to eat their burgers and fries within its ancient walls. The cosiest room was within the stair tower or garderobe tower. Diners may not have been aware that what they were sitting in was probably partly at least a medieval toilet block. Almost next door can just be detected remnants of another medieval townhouse within 14 to 16 Pride Hill. Now divided into three later premises, there survives another huge medieval undercroft, of which externally some stonework and a small medieval window can be seen today from Raven Meadows. It's more impressive inside, but it's inaccessible within modern properties. It was probably originally the townhouse of the Pride family, who've given their name to the whole street. Moving along, we reach the huge bulk of the rear of the Darwin shopping centre. This masks what would once have been a varied skyline of buildings along the ridge behind Pride Hill and Castle Street. The loss of this skyline was already underway by the 1960s, when new department stores like Woolworths and Littlewoods made their appearance and in so doing replaced venerable structures that got in their way. Perhaps the best-loved of Shrewsbury's Victorian buildings was the Raven Hotel, whose Gothic windows added character to Castle Street. At the rear lay not only the hotel garage, but also a mysterious stone structure. This was most likely part of the 13th century town walls, but it was much larger than the other interval towers along the wall, and may have been an even earlier structure, perhaps like Garriwold's Tower that we saw earlier. We shall never know, as it was demolished in the 1960s. Another grievous loss at that time was the old Church Farm Cafe at 8A Castle Street. This was possibly the earliest timber frame building in the town. It was originally an open hall, that is, it was open from the floor to the roof with no intervening ceiling, and would originally have had a fire in a grate on the floor. A similar but surviving structure is the Bare Steps Hall off Fish Street. The smoke-blackened roof timbers with their braces are seen here. A half-hearted suggestion that it be saved and moved elsewhere came to nothing, and Littlewoods was built on its site. It and its neighbour Woolworths were linked by a walkway at their rear, which eventually continued across a bridge to a new multi-storey car park. The old skyline appears again as we approach the rear of houses along school gardens and the library. Well restored in the 1980s, but not without more destruction of the town wall behind it, which was reduced in height at that time. Finally, we reach the junction with Meadow Place and the start of our circuit. Let's now explore the large area within this circuit, which has seen huge changes over the last 170 years. On the Burley map of 1575, we can see that the area known as Raven Meadows had not been developed. It was low-lying and even more susceptible to flooding than it is today. This isn't surprising because, as we've seen, the River Severn itself would have once, a few thousand years earlier, passed over its site, carving out the ridge along which Pride Hill, Castle Street and Castle Gates were later built. It's uncertain exactly what the land was used for prior to the 19th century, but as pastureland and water meadow seem the most likely. This was ideal for fattening up of livestock before slaughter, and it's also possible that some crops essential for trades in the town, such as madder, woad and flax, may have been grown there. Either way, it shows how the links between the town and agriculture were much closer than today. Despite being a market town with a large agricultural hinterland, Shrewsbury was still in the early 19th century without any facilities for the sale of incoming produce other than the open streets themselves. The result was considerable congestion on the regular Wednesday and Saturday market days, and even more when the monthly butter and cheese fairs took place. By the mid-19th century, however, these issues had been largely dealt with. Butter markets in Howard Street and Pride Hill and a new general market hall in the triangle of land between Claremont Street, Mardole Head and Bellstone provided undercover accommodation for corn, vegetables and dairy products. And in the 1840s, discussions for a cattle market site centred on Abbey Foregate and Raven Meadows. The former was too small and the latter was prone to flooding. But nevertheless, on the 19th of November 1850, the Smithfield Cattle Market opened on Raven Meadows. It was marked by a dinner for over 100 farmers at the nearby Britannia Inn on Mardole. In preparation, the ground level was raised by the dumping of rubble and soil in places by as much as 2.9 metres, as we've seen, burying the Rouse Hill wall in the process. The pens and buildings of the market then appeared at a cost of £20,000, which finally banished live animal trading from the town's streets. The proximity of the nearby railway station, opened only 2 years earlier with its good sidings, made the transport of livestock a much easier and speedier process. Not all livestock arrived by train, however, and the herding of such livestock through the streets on the way to market remained a common sight well into the 20th century. The cattle market changed very little over the next century and can best be seen in this wonderful film made in 1959, just before its closure. Here we can see one of the entrances near to Meadow Place, with a market toll house coming into view. Another entrance was further along Smithfield Road, near the Victoria Hotel. Looking back, we see the circuit wall plastered with advertisements. We can see how important the market would have been to nearby pubs like the Victoria and why they struggled when the market closed. Everywhere, farmers can be seen in their ubiquitous raincoats. The Smithfield Market witnessed the sale of all types of livestock, from pigs to cattle to sheep and more. Buying and selling was now by auction, rather than by private deals sealed with a drink in a nearby pub. And livestock were no longer traded in streets. So, here is the auction room where deals were settled. We leave this scene by the entrance near the abattoir off Rouse Hill along the Old Cross Lane, the final exit for many of the creatures traded here. In 1959, the market was moved to Harlescote and the look and feel of the area changed completely. Gone were the sounds of livestock close to the town centre, and pubs no longer filled with farmers on market days. The cattle market was not the only facility with its origins in the 19th and early 20th century in the area. Behind the Raven Hotel stood the Raven Horse Repository, a reminder that until the 1920s, horse transport for goods and people remained more common than cars and lorries. To the east lay the Shrewsbury Electric Light Works power station, built in 1893 and closed in the mid-1950s at the foot of 70 steps shut. There was a rope walk, a new abattoir, and a malt house on the corner of Rouse Hill and Cross Lane. With the closure of the Smithfield Market, a vast area of open land was now available for redevelopment, and plans were not long in coming. They were ambitious ideas for a mix of leisure and retail uses, although residential use seems not to have been considered. A bowling alley, ice rink, riverside restaurant, and luxury hotel were all mooted. The model shown in these photos reflects the zeitgeist of those days, the ambition and optimism of the swinging 60s, and the strong belief in the simple lines of modern architecture in concrete, steel and glass, without reference to past architectural styles. Sadly, the leisure functions were later watered down, although a nightclub, Tiffany's, did appear and remains today, albeit after many name changes. Offices in the form of Telephone House opened in 1962. This tall block had the reputation of swaying in high winds and was eventually demolished in 2002. A Premier Inn now stands on the site, belatedly and partly fulfilling the ambition for leisure facilities envisaged back in the early 1960s. At the same time, a multi-storey car park appeared. Rouse Hill was doubled in width, and Raven Meadows became a through route, linking one end of the area to the other, making possible the servicing of the new offices and shops, and opening up the prospect of future development on the slopes below Pride Hill and Castle Street. It was to be over 20 years before development on the scale of that of the early 1960s took place, when two large shopping centres were built that enhanced Shrewsbury's retail offer, albeit with a strong focus on national retail chains. In the intervening years, there had been a change in attitude towards the town's historic buildings, and there wasn't quite the destruction of ancient buildings there had been when Woolies and Littlewoods were built in the 60s, although, as we've seen, a remaining section of medieval town wall was removed. Instead, there were two discrete insertions into Pride Hill for the main entrances, and an attempt was made to harmonise with the character of the rest of the town in the, at the time, fashionable neo-vernacular manner. The smaller of the two, the Pride Hill Centre of 1985 to 88, with its light, airy interior, achieved this more successfully by creating a varied street frontage to Rouse Hill that visually emphasised the steep hill on which it was built. The Darwin Shopping Centre of 1986 to 90 also used a neo-vernacular style, with its referencing to the town's timber-framed building tradition, but on an enormous scale. It is noticeably bigger and had the difficult task of incorporating large existing retail units within it and linking to the nearby multi-storey car park, to which an extra two storeys were added. Next to it, a new bus station was built on an area of open land. The Darwin Shopping Centre largely achieved its functional aims, but the vast block at the rear, stretching along a considerable length of Castle Street and Pride Hill, obscured the natural topography and has largely completed the gradual process of the destruction of the historic skyline, with its many and varied buildings on its ridge that characterised the view of the town from the west as recently as the early 1960s. Only in short, precious stretches near the library and in the gap site between the two shopping centres can this still be experienced. Neither shopping centre took advantage of their height to provide commanding views to the west, and instead turned blank, windowless faces to Raven Meadows and the river. In 1993, the Riverside Shopping Centre was linked to the Pride Hill Centre and revamped. Architecturally, this involved toning down the 1960s look, removing a modernist clock tower that stood at its centre, and dressing the concrete structures with traditional building materials similar to those used on the Pride Hill Shopping Centre. An entrance from Smithfield Road was blocked off, and the centre joined its bigger neighbours in completely ignoring the river. In 2012, major plans were approved for the demolition of the Riverside Shopping Centre and its replacement with a large expansion of shopping space, 50 new shops and 15 cafes and restaurants. The design once again reflected current thinking, this time with huge areas of glass to let natural light flood in, a reaction to the sometimes claustrophobic malls that had previously characterised indoor shopping. Arguably the most attractive of all the shopping developments suggested for the Riverside area, it was put on hold in 2013. It had proved to be overly ambitious during a time of economic difficulty. Online shopping, too, was already making heavy inroads into traditional forms of retail, and national chains like Woolworths, on which such shopping centres thrive, were going under. Plans were finally dropped when all three shopping centres were bought by Shropshire Council. It would probably have surprised public and planners alike back in the 1960s to find that it has been the traditional smaller shops, often with residential uses above them and housed in ancient buildings, that have proved the most resilient in the town centre, rather than the big shopping centres that seemed at the time set to replace them. As we have seen, the area has been the site of considerable redevelopment over a relatively short period of time. Little of this has been of a notable visual quality, but it has at least provided the town with a breathing space for activities that, had they been placed elsewhere in the historic town centre, would inevitably have caused great destruction. Now the area faces another spate of redevelopment, informed by the successes and failures of the past. There are opportunities to conserve and better present the precious vestiges of an earlier pre-industrial Shrewsbury that survive around its edges. To reconnect the town with the river, on which in this area alone it has turned its back in recent years. To provide that balanced mix of residential, leisure and retail development that has thus far proved strangely elusive. And to create an adventurous architecture that reflects the needs and concerns of the 21st century, but which is of a quality to match the best of earlier centuries in the town. It's an exciting prospect.